department, I'm sorry, is the Department of License Inspection. Commissioner Williams and whoever else is volunteering to come up with you. Afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
If you'd like to proceed, I'm sure you're summarized testimony, and then
yes.
We'll, I think there might be a question or two. So.
All right. Good afternoon, Councilman Greenlee.
Afternoon.
And thank you for the honor, members of City Council, for allowing us to be here to testify today. I am Carlton Williams, Commissioner of the Department of License and Inspections. I am pleased to be here today to testify on the fiscal year 2015 operating budget. Joining me here today are Deputy Commissioners Michael Fink and Michael Maynard, along with members of the Department of Licenses and Inspections. The Department of Licenses and Inspections is requesting a total FY15 general fund budget of $27,564,000, which represents an increase of $1.97 million from FY14. The FY15 request will fund 353 general fund positions and includes a $9.3 million demolition budget. The $1.97 million increase will support 27 new building inspectors, 2 assistant city solicitors, 1 paralegal, 5 service reps, and an education and outreach plan that will strive to inform the public about building safety and the new demolition standards. In addition, OSHA 30 training will be provided to all L&I inspectors. The department experienced major challenges in FY14, none greater than the tragic building collapse that occurred on June 5th, 2013. This incident has caused us to take a closer look at our entire department's operations to help ensure public safety in the construction industry. The department is committed to public safety. In keeping with our mission to be the nation's leader in code enforcement, we created new demolition regulations, which became part of the new legislation established by City Council and signed into law by the mayor. The new building and administrative codes are stricter than what was required by previous codes. Part of these regulations require contractors to submit detailed site safety plans and insurance and licensing information with each permit application, among the other requirements. In addition to the new demolition standards, the department continues its focus on improving public safety through targeted demolitions of imminently dangerous properties, expanded technological capabilities through Project Eclipse, and the hiring of the 27 new inspectors that will be a part of the newly created Emergency Services Unit and the Compliance Unit. These units will specifically target unlicensed, unpermitted, and unsafe construction and demolition sites, as well as respond to building emergencies and imminently dangerous structures. The new units will complement the work of our development division by providing additional oversight on top of the code-required inspections conducted by our building inspectors. Many of these policies and procedures have already undergone a 2-year review by the International Accreditation Service, which is part of the International Code Council, the entity that writes the building codes we follow and enforce. This review measured our practices against other municipalities and culminated with the department receiving accreditation as a leader in the code enforcement industry. Currently, L&I is working with outside agencies to review our practices and develop additional meaningful reforms. We are fully cooperating with numerous audits and investigations from various agencies, including the Controller's Office, the District Attorney's Office, the Inspector General's Office, and the Special Independent Advisory Commission that was created under the Mayor's executive order. We will continue to make significant progress in FY15 towards improving services and public safety. The hardworking employees of the department will continue to make Philadelphia a better, safer place to live, work, and play. Thank you for the opportunity to present our FY15 budget. I'm available to answer any questions at this time.
Hey, thank you, Commissioner. Let me just ask one question before I know other members want to ask questions. I have a feeling that demolition might be come up a few times in question.
Sure.
And I know you say in your written testimony that L&I has received an overwhelming influx of complaints dealing with immediate demolitions. And I know there's been some, even with the addition of the $3 million in the FY14 demolition budget, your department's already spent 5.58, and you still have 600 properties designated imminently dangerous. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. Could you kind of just get into that, describe the challenges your department's facing, that kind of thing, and is
sure.
there any target date when those, when you at least think that those properties could be addressed?
Yes. First, we average about $13,500 per residential property. That gives us enough funding currently at the $9 million mark to take care of the 600 properties. Correct. The challenge, though, is that this is a revolving model, meaning that the more we take down, we get complaints about unsafe conditions that have deteriorated to the point where we have to take action. So it's never a constant number. It's always revolving. And so that number, it will be 300, or we'll have it down to 300 or 400 by the end of this year, and another 200 properties will go on the list, especially after winter weather conditions that we had this past winter season. Those cause properties, vacant properties, to deteriorate even faster. And so that's the challenge that we currently face and we constantly battle.
And just as a follow-up to this, some of the things that were written in the newspaper today, particularly city-owned properties, how are they handled in any way differently or when they're imminently dangerous?
Well, we follow the same process and procedure. We notify the agencies immediately when they are brought to our attention. And we either that through a proactive inspection or through a complaint from a citizen. And so once we are aware of it, we notify the agency immediately to get permission to take action on that property. Public property, those belong to the Department of Public Property. We handle through our general demolition budget. Other agencies, we ask for a reimbursement, and we get paid through a reimbursement process. Mm-hmm. So agencies like PHA, PRA, RDA, all of those properties that are listed under their jurisdiction, they give us authorization to demolish.
And they give you all, do you have a pretty good working relationship with those agencies?
Absolutely. Okay. Once we bring it to their attention, and they have their own processes in PHA that they have to follow to get authorization to release it. If it's ID, though, we automatically take it down and build them, and we have not had any problems with any communication with getting either reimbursed or having a property demolished when we say it's in need of emergency.
Okay. All right. Thank you. All right, let's go to the members. First, Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
And thank you, Commissioner, and your staff for the work we did together to take a look at where we were by way of demolition, both public and private, and then subsequently coming up with recommendation 75 of which we agreed upon, and maybe two we had a little question on, but that's remarkable for us to be able to co-venture on that and come up with a common vision for what would be now a part of the city code and a part of the day-to-day practice of your department. So I want to thank all of you who participated in that. And it makes me feel a lot more confident that going forward we'll have a better handle on what's going on in our city.
Thank you, Councilman.
So with that, how much is all this going to cost?
Well, as I indicated in our opening remarks, $1.97 million is what we estimate the cost for the 27 additional inspectors. Those inspectors will perform meaningful responsibilities to increase oversight, which we thought was one of the challenges in our department, mainly on dangerous construction sites to ensure contractors are following the rules. We've also put in new policies to complement those inspectors. In our compliance division, we'll make sure that many of the legislative issues that was brought up by council are addressed, things such as making sure that contractors have insurance documents and they're paying their fair share of taxes are something that we just didn't have the staffing capacities before to check. But now with this new budget, we're able to go back and look at to ensure that they have those basic necessary requirements before even starting the job.
So I believe in a transfer ordinance, Mr. Chairman, we just did a figure of about, what is it, $3
million? $3 million, that's
correct. $3 million to deal with outstanding issues, properties that need to be torn down, and immediate steps that you might have needed to take to modernize your IT or things like that. Can you give us a sense of how that money's being spent? And then what the additional appropriations in the upcoming fiscal year will be applied towards? And if you would do it in a way where you said, this is how we used to do it, this is how we're going to do it going forward, I think it aids in our understanding of the changes within your department.
Sure. Well, the $3 million would immediately go to public demolitions. We, due to the issues that I pointed out earlier, the increased weather conditions that caused properties to deteriorate at a much faster rate. The type of properties we were demolishing as well. There was a church at 2842 North 9th Street, a very huge church that cost over $962,000 to demolish. That ate into our demolition funding at a much faster rate than traditionally we would spend. But it was an eminently dangerous property that we had to address. And so that $3 million mid-year transfer will go directly towards finishing the identified properties that we declared eminently dangerous for the rest of the fiscal year. One of the challenges, again, is to identify and package those up in a way that it maximizes the resources of our investment. And so therefore, we're going from area to area around the city of Philadelphia, trying to get those properties that are in close proximity under a package deal where we can get the best bang for our dollars and our investment for the city of Philadelphia. Therefore, we would be able to take even more of those properties down. That process will not stop with next year's budget. We will continue to roll into the summer after FY15, starting July 1st, and continue to knock down the other 580 properties that we currently have on our demolition listing. So those were where those funds directly were used. There are changes that we have in terms of our the legislation that council, once again, we thank you for that, that put together and signed into law by the mayor that will take place immediately. Immediate changes to permit application requirements and the permit inspection process. Some of these things will go into effect 7-1, the new fiscal year. Others will take the full 18 months to incorporate because it takes time for us to build. And I'll give you some examples if you would allow me the opportunity to do so. So under the permit application requirements, permits, what we used to provide is an over-the-counter demolition permit. Now it's treated as a 20-day plan review in which an examiner thoroughly looks at the entire application process. And some of the things that are now included in that application check is to make sure that a site safety plan and a work schedule is provided, reviewed by an inspector and provided by a competent person in which our plan examiners have the opportunity to verify. In addition, work experience of the contractor was also a consideration under the application projects for demolitions as well. So that was one of the changes in the permit application process. We estimated about, it's taken on average between 30 and 40 days since we initiated it, and that's because it took time for contractors to get adjusted to the requirements. But on average,
just as you have in mid-process of developing these regs cited some contractors that were in non-compliance, some of whom actually came to my office talking about what's going on. We used to do it this way. Now it's unacceptable. And, you know, so you can talk about how it's impacted the business as usual approach. Well, I mean, I can tell you from a constituent service basis.
It's changed.
And when the contractor came in with it, I had to tell him, we're not doing it that way anymore, and you have to take seriously the regulations over in L&I. So I could tell you it's had immediate impact.
The industry, the demolition industry, I met with some of the larger contractors who expressed frustration with getting their permits approved. But again, after explaining to them why it was important, I think they understood it. But they also asked, would we be open to looking at ways to always improve the system so that we don't compromise safety, but to ensure development as well. And I certainly accepted that invitation and would be more than willing to continue that process so that we can improve and streamline process without sacrificing public safety. Some of the other things that we're requiring, especially in this upcoming fiscal year, is the signage requirement. At one point for larger buildings, it's important that the public understands what's happening in their districts and in their communities so that they have a contact person to be able to immediately call if there was an emergency or if they see something that appeared to be unsafe. Then our department should be contacted so that we can send an inspector out immediately. I think that when there's no information or no signs and people begin to speculate what's going on and they don't have a contact, that raises fears. So our department is now requiring that certain size buildings require a large sign, but all other construction projects at least has visible signage where people will know who the contractor is, an estimated date when the project is expected to commence and be completed, who to contact in case there's a problem or an issue in with the site, or if they have any questions about the contractor's permit requirements. Those are some of the things that were not existed in the past, but now are in place today.
I'm going to yield to, because I heard the bell toll.
It did go. We have everybody that's here teed up. So
I'm going to yield, and I'll come around
sure.
on second round, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilman. Thank you very much. Councilwoman Tasco?
Good afternoon. Thank you so much. I just came down here to say I want to thank you for you, your leadership, and the L&I department, and working with us on the building on 13th Street, where we had the, we have many serious problems there. And I just wanted to say that I appreciated your the support you gave us when you were in the streets department. And when you left, I said, oh, no, you can't leave. But I'm glad you're at L&I.
Thank you, Councilman.
Because your commitment to understanding what's going on in this city, and particularly in the neighborhoods, is very important to us.
Thank you, sir.
And I'd just like for you, for the record, to sort of give a slight summary of some of the changes that we discussed in our private meeting with you mm-hmm. about how in the future you hopefully we won't have this kind of situation again. I've had three buildings in my district where we've had to evacuate families at the last minute or in the middle of the night because the landlords are either absent or the systems, the way the building is structured and managed doesn't work in the best interest of the residents. And a couple of weeks ago, we had to give those residents in that building a 5-day notice that they had to move, which was very painful for all of us. But you and your staff worked hard to see that we tried to make it as less painful as possible. So just for the record, so that my colleagues will know what you were able to accomplish, and hopefully we will look forward to, in the future, a way to avoid this situation. Mm-hmm. And that's what we really want, the end product. How do we avoid it?
Right. Thank you, Councilwoman, for your kind words, first of all, and specifically on the property at the 6700 block of North 13th Street. That was a very difficult situation. Anytime you're displacing residents and families with children and having to redirect them so suddenly is always a difficult decision. I can tell you a little history about the property, and I'm also going to ask my Deputy Commissioner Mike Maynard to talk about it as well. But the property in itself, when we visited on several occasions, had multiple violations. I think this situation was much more challenging in that it wasn't one apartment building where they had one viable owner. They had converted those units into many condominium units. Some had an agency that was responsible for part of the building. Others were individually owned. And so there was no one unit to say we're responsible for all the common areas. And so the problem with that is that, especially in a fire, if they don't have a functioning fire system, or if there's an unsafe or uninhabitable condition, as which we saw at that site where they had feces and things in the basement, people were using buckets for bathrooms, that just was living conditions that we could no longer tolerate. And so that action had to be taken place. Some of the things that we can do better is, first of all, to try to work the owners to make sure that they get compliance in the first place. I think that comes along with not only the Department of L&I, but us working closely together with our legal team and the court process. Therefore, we can try to get owners in the court faster, quicker to address these situations. One of the challenges that I've put forth to the mayor's office and within our own division is to restructure our code violation resolution unit, which is the unit responsible for processing cases for court. Therefore, if we're able to get properties in court faster and identify who those owners are, we can get greater compliance if we get support from the judicial system to find owners and to force them and issue orders to comply. But it's a constant battle when you're dealing with the number of cases that we have. Specifically, we discussed in your district as that we would look at these building type structures so that we can pilot and do more frequent inspections of those type of properties. We know three happened in your area. There's a number of others citywide, but to look at a program that allow us to be more proactive in our inspection process so that we can identify hazard conditions and have them addressed before it gets to the point of a cease operation where people have to be displaced. Deputy Commissioner Maynor, would you like to add?
In the case of this building was a condominium, which is kind of unique because there are 59 separate owners. The department took the building to court. We couldn't find a clear owner, and no one would step to the plate, and it gradually got worse. There was a $5,000 fine in municipal court. Since there was no clear owners, again, the building kept getting worse and worse. So we had to give, unfortunately, I mean, we don't take this lightly. Cease operations, we have an 8-page procedure on how to perform a cease operations. Moving people out of a building, we don't take lightly. So we gave a 35-day intent to cease order. It seemed like the tenants kind of didn't take that cease order seriously enough. What we do when we issue the intent to cease, we post each side of the building, we post each door in the entryway into the building, we send letters to each of the units within the building, 59 units, and we hand deliver them in first class mail. So after 35 days, it didn't seem like anyone took that seriously, so an additional 5 days were given to actually move out. The people were given support with OASH, which we thank a great deal for, and also the Sheriff's Department, who helped us with the cease operations order. But again, that's a last resort. Our department does not like to do that. That's not a way we can continue to do. So.
Well, I know we were happy to have in our meeting with you, Clarina Tolson, from the Revenue Department, who discussed working with your office in referring properties with multiple violations to Revenue for possible use of a receivership as a tool. So I know it was a real mess with the way that building is configured and how they are real slick in setting up that the building the way it is. And hopefully we will monitor that so we won't go back into that slide.
Definitely, that will be part of our process, and we'll keep your office updated on those type of building structures for every building in your district.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilwoman. Councilman Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. How you doing, Colin?
How are you, Councilman?
Doing pretty good.
Good.
Just want to run, was about to call you last night because I have some rogue developers in the back of my house about 9:30, the generator on. So we just called now. It was the wife, actually, so we just called 911 and got it taken care of. But, yeah, so. Question. So regarding the demolitions that are taking place, and thank you for the actual data for my district to give me an idea of what my district looks like when it comes to properties or houses that need to be demoed. Is there a partnership with the Revenue Department and the Office of Property Assessment to specifically look at those properties that are privately owned, that are on our rolls, that you have to demo? And obviously, the more houses you demo comes out of your budget.
Correct.
But putting together a process with those two departments, so once you demo those houses, we have a way to put those houses back on the market so you can recoup some of the revenue that was spent for the demolition.
Yeah, the process, and we would prefer to certainly try to salvage any building that is marketable. I think one of the successful programs that the department launched, and this was done prior to me taking leadership in L&I, was the vacant property strategy that continues to be a success story today. The vacant property strategy as a targeted proactive enforcement program that identifies properties and marketable communities to hold property owners accountable through various methods. And one of the methods and tools that we use is the doors and window strategy. The doors and window strategy holds the owner of a vacant property accountable to ensure that every opening is sealed with either a door or a window, or face a $300 per day per opening penalty if they do not comply. And that is issued by a judicial order. But the value of that is that when we see those properties salvaged and saved, and their owner either does something to put it back into productive use or sells it to someone who can, then it allows the market value of the surrounding neighborhood to increase. The Reinvestment Fund did a study that showed there was a $74 million market sale value to those properties in areas in which we provided that type of enforcement, and a $2.3 million tax incentive for the city. So it's an effective strategy.
So let's go with the actual parcels of land that are private, that are the vacant parcels of land that are private as the result of the city going out to demo those properties. What happens to that private land now? And how do we get that private land back on the market?
Yeah, a lien is placed on
And at what point do we confiscate? Because I guess my issue has always been, and I always have put it out there from a development standpoint, you know, people try to get my position, you know, affordable market rate, and I'm for just smart development. And I would be remiss if I don't talk about how, you know, and growing up, at least in my neighborhood in Point Breeze, you know, it's probably the hottest market right now. We have a lot of private, not talking about city-owned land, private-owned land that developers came in, purchased, and these properties just sitting there as a blight inside the neighborhood. And so what happens to those particular properties? Because we have a role to play as a city, so we'll do opportunity zones, we'll focus on mixed-use housing development strategies, but on the private side, there's a significant amount of private properties and parcels of land that are back on their taxes, and even some that's not even back on their taxes, they're just sitting there, that serves as a blight from speculators. I mean, how are we addressing it from the ones who are back on their taxes, and they're just not taking care of their properties and their lands? And at what point do you continue to give liens, and although they're paying the liens, but not taking care of the actual property? At what point do we step in and exercise our full authority?
Well, I think that it's certainly a conversation that revenue needs to be a part of, because if there's a tax issue, that is their forte in terms of taking those properties to the sheriff's cell. Our role in that process is to control blight, and if we have to take actions to remediate that property, or there's fines that are generated through the court structure for someone who is neglectful of their property, then liens can be placed on that property, and it's twofold. They could take that to the sheriff's cell as well.
Mm-hmm. My initial revenue department, yeah. And OPA, because I'm sure some of these houses that you're demolishing right now have to be privately owned properties, correct?
Right. Those that we believe that will go through sheriff's sale process for resale that are attractive, we send 20 properties per month to the Department of Revenue to consider for sheriff's sale. Probably would have to have a conversation with revenue to see how effective our strategy would be, but we are working in cooperation with revenue to see how those properties are being turned over to the public to be back to put back in a productive use. So we do have a good relationship with revenue.
Okay. Thank you. Carl.
Thank you, Councilman. Councilman O.
Mr. Chairman, good morning, Commissioner.
Good morning.
Let me just say, along with my colleagues, that we know that you've jumped into a big job, and you know, you've done a great job, and thank you very much for doing a great job and being so accessible and helpful. I just have a couple questions. One is just a kind of a minor question. I'm looking at the fiscal 2015 proposed appropriations. And there's a significant increase for equipment from typically $75,000 or $55,000 to $335,000. Is there a anticipated purchase or replacement of equipment that's going to happen?
Well, with additional staff, they need the tools to actually do their job. So there will be an investment in technology. I think part of that is required also that per council legislation that they wanted to see expanded training, and we agreed about OSHA training. Those are some of the things that that funding would support. And also we need to do a better job of educating the public about our policies and procedures to gain compliance. So within those three areas is where you're seeing where that investment will be made.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
In terms of the demolitions, the clean and seals, the demolition of residential buildings remaining for this year, I understand that the budget is about $9 million. You spent about $5.5 million, and you have remaining about $3.4 million. Is that correct?
Yeah, it's about $3 million now. We've done some packages this week to demo property, so you're in the range, yes.
So there are still about 600 properties that have been identified as imminent danger. Are they going to get, what is the plan or process for addressing those demolitions based on the remaining amount in your budget?
Well, the $3 million that we have covered will take care of estimated 200 properties that remain. Now, that's not an exact science, because if we get a large vacant commercial that we have to respond to an emergency from a fire, that could eat up into part of that budget. And so those are the kind of the hidden items that are not told. It's not all for a residential property at $13,000. It could vary in size and cost. So those are the challenges that we face with. But what we plan to do is to obviously identify ones in residential communities where it's densely populated that someone is at risk of getting hurt. And so we try to identify those as the highest priority. So the goal is to try to take down 200 of those properties based in the residential communities. If something did come up, as they often do, in a large vacant area, then we would have to obviously respond and use that funding for that. But that is the plan. Vacants, as I mentioned earlier, is a revolving process. It's not 600 and we're done. The city is now safe. It's constant. So we're constantly inspecting buildings. Unsafe buildings get upgraded to from unsafe to imminently dangerous. An unsafe building could be something that's repairable at the time, but over time, as the winters come and the deterioration process starts, it could be easily upgraded to a imminently dangerous property. So that's kind of how the process works, and it's continuously ongoing battle, which is why we need to come up with a solution to stop it from getting in that condition in the first place.
Okay, so 600 buildings are identified as imminently dangerous. So that sounds kind of bad to me. What exact is there a general estimated period of time in general that you use to approach these 600 buildings?
Sure. There is a process that we have 13 public demolition contractors who bid on these jobs. The goal is to try to maximize the use of the funding that we currently have, which is $3 million remaining and then $9 million for next year. So what we do is we map and target those properties in various neighborhoods and try to package deal them so that we're taking down five and six at one time. The value, and bidding that out, the value to that is that you get a cheaper price and you get much faster response from the contractors as opposed to individually trying to take one down one by one. Therefore, we're maximizing the use of the funds that the city has in order to take these properties down at a much faster rate. If you were to give me a timetable, again, each year we took down 500 properties, so within a given year we're going to take down all 600 of those properties.
Does this include the fire remediation when a fire occurs? Fire remediation folks come in onto the scene, or is that separate because that's covered by typically homeowners insurance, or if there's no insurance, is it covered by the city?
That's separate. That comes from the city's homeowner's policy, the remediation to repair. We take care of a property when we have to take it down and cause action to make it safe. So if there is a fire and the fire department contacts us to assess the structural condition of a building, and if it's dangerous as a result of that fire, we then take action by bringing one of our demolition contractors up to take it down, and then a lien is placed on the property to go after our funding that we've expended to try to address the unsafe situation.
Okay, I'll have to come back because the bell has rung. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilman. Councilwoman Reynolds Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Good afternoon, Councilman.
I have a lot of questions in 5 minutes, so I'm going to use 30 to say to commend you and the manner in which you handled the tragedy that was before the city and your partnership with Majority Leader and the Special Committee in tackling in a real in-depth, piercing way about what and how we need to conduct ourselves differently as a city and as a department going forward.
That was not an
easy time for any of us. And being in leadership, I know it was truly a struggle for you.
Yes, ma'am.
Did not go unnoticed.
Yes,
okay?
Ma'am. Thank you.
So, read with interest this one article, and in it you state, LNI has about 80 inspectors, 13 demolition contractors, and you're considering training other staffers to help out with smaller demolition requests. So my thinking goes to this question. Has there been any opportunity to cross-train? First of all, what's the qualification or training process for building inspectors? And has there been an opportunity to cross-train, because no longer can we as professionals operate in a silo with one skill set, given limited dollars and humongous needs? Has there been any consideration for that?
Thank you, Councilwoman. And I'll certainly be as direct as possible, and then I'll turn it over to Deputy Commissioner Michael Fink to talk about the training of the building inspectors. One of the things that we addressed in that article today about the 80 inspectors, there are several units responsible for overseeing blight in the city. Some units are directly responsible for dealing with the structural condition of a building. Mm-hmm. Others are responsible for identifying it. Most of that 80 inspectors that was stated earlier, 60 of them come from our property maintenance division. Those are the ones that are out in the street looking at violations for pre-existing buildings.
Pre-existing buildings, right. They're on the front line, if you will.
Right, exactly. Now, when there's an emergency, if they recognize something that may be structurally dangerous, we have an emergency services unit that goes out and does an assessment to verify whether it's unsafe or imminently dangerous. Mm-hmm. And right now, out of that 80, that's 13 of those inspectors. This new budget allows me to push that 13 up to about 27 new inspectors that will be out there addressing emergency situations, which I think fills a critical need.
So will these be new professionals from the outside, or are these persons from other city departments like public property where there's an opportunity to be promoted so that they come to this new unit with some sense of the big picture?
Yeah, these are new inspectors that will have to meet certain qualifications to be accepted into the city's program. Mm-hmm. And again, to talk about those certifications for a building inspector and the training process, I'll turn it over to Deputy Commissioner Michael Fink,
okay,
who can explain that to you as
Thank
well.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Councilman.
Good afternoon.
All of our building inspectors are required to be certified by the state code in all of the codes that they enforce. So, for instance, if you're doing a mechanical inspection, you need to have mechanical code certification.
Mm-hmm.
If you're doing a building inspection, you need building code certification. If you're doing a plumbing inspection, you need plumbing code certification. So what we do is we bring in people from the trades with trades experience or with college degrees in construction management to be inspector trainees. So they have a background in construction, but then we begin to train them in the codes themselves.
Gotcha.
At the same time that they're going to classes to learn the codes and become certified, we're training them on how to do inspections, how to use our database, how to write reports. So within approximately a year, up to 18 months, they obtain 4 certifications, which allow them to do the basic building code enforcement for a permit inspection, so any construction project that you're doing. Then we encourage them to get additional certifications that go above and beyond the state's requirements. And through that, they're full performance. They can do minimal plan review, and they can also do high-rise inspections
okay.
for new construction. So in addition to that, with the recent legislation, in addition to all that training, we'll now be training them on OSHA requirements.
Very
We're
good.
Working now with OSHA to get them the OSHA 30 training that the council has suggested that we we accomplish, and also we're doing quarterly training sessions for our construction inspectors on specific safety issues that OSHA feels are problematic in this area. For instance, they'll do one on scaffolding, one on excavations.
Okay.
And we have an ongoing cooperation with OSHA where our referrals to them, they're beginning to count those and see how productive they are. And then we're hitting about an 82% OSHA activity on the referrals that they're getting from our inspectors.
Mm-hmm. So let me make sure I understand that. 82% on referrals from, who'd you say?
Our inspectors will contact OSHA when they see a worker in danger. They
I
have the
see.
Right to stop the job, but they also contact OSHA to tell them that they've observed somebody doing improper, according to OSHA regulations. That's over and above the building code regulations. So when they, because of the training that we've received from OSHA, and there will be more, we're able to identify what OSHA violations are and make referrals to them. Then 82% of the time when we call them, they've opened up a case where they've been able to take penalties against the contract.
Very good. So on this question, on this issue, then is it fair to say that as a result of the work of the committee, the special committee, and the commissioner, this is one of the new protocols, if you will, that have been instituted? Is that fair to say?
Yes, Councilman, that's
correct. Okay. All right, then, thank you. I'll wait for the next round. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Keona Sanchez.
Thank you, Mr. President.
You're welcome.
Good afternoon. I, too, want to echo Councilwoman Reynolds Brown's congratulations to the work that you did with the special committee led by Councilman Jones. I think a lot of the work that came from there was very thoughtful. And I also appreciate the fact that in the special independent advisory commission where we have developers and building tradesmen, there's a lot of scrutiny going on, and it's not easy to have so many hands in your pot looking at what you're doing. And I think it's because of your leadership, Commissioner, and being open to having people look at it and provide feedback and recommendations that I think you're going to have a better department at the end of all this process and all this scrutiny. I wanted, because the most important unit to me right now as it relates to what we've seen in the public scrutiny is this compliance unit. And so one of our frustrations and the frustrations of residents is they have a problem house and the process. You know, you do the 30-day re-inspect, somebody else comes in, it opens up a new ticket. Can you tell me, then, you know, the issue of when you take people to equity court, who makes that decision? Can you tell me from beginning to end, when there's a problem property, how you're going to streamline that process and what should be the expectation of people as it relates to those problem properties? I know you get an uptick of calls because now, you know, with the weather, you know, people, houses are collapsing. But what ideally do you want to see that compliance unit do, and is that enough resources to get you there in response to the expectation?
Yeah. I'm going to ask the Emergency Services Duties Director, Scott Mulderick, to come up to talk about our current practice, and then also I'm going to talk about our compliance division and what I envision, how we're going to improve public safety. And also talking about restructuring the court process so that we could address these issues at a much faster and quicker rate. One of the challenges with the emergency duty inspectors is to be able to identify and get a case in the court as quickly as possible. Part of the responsibility under Mr. Mulderick and his staff is to be able to have court time allocated to ensure that that happens. Some things require the same day, and we can get a case in court depending on the condition of a structure. If we believe that it's about to fall or it's in such egregious conditions that it requires a judge to talk about it, we can get a case in the court within 24 hours. The other part of it is, and I'm sure Mr. Mulderick will talk about, is the process of due process, in which we have to give an owner the opportunity to comply, because we can then get into a lot of legal trouble if we act on a situation without getting an order to fix or address. And so the court process plays an extremely important role in that. But before getting to the court process, before I turn it over to Mr. Mulderick, You have to have a process that identifies problems before they become major problems. And if you're putting everything in through a court system that allows it to log jam, then ultimately the more serious danger cases just get shuttled in with the less serious problems. So the goal is to take those issues out of the case processing system and handle it through other ways. So if you have a case for high weeds or grass or trash violations, use a fine system and take about 8,000 of those properties cases out of the system so that you can enforce things like drainage issues on a property or a damaged rooftop or you see decay in bricks. Those are the ways in which you stop a property from deteriorating to the point where it comes in where you have to have the emergency services unit put it in equity court. So those are the things that we're looking for, not only our compliance division to address on the contractor side, on the building side, but emergency, but our CVR unit, case processing unit, needs to change as well. I'm going to briefly
respond to the whole issue of the bond issue that we've still been debating about requiring a certain bond so that we can try to recoup some of these costs?
Yeah, we're looking in that with the law department because we understand that it's been a challenge for large vacant properties to obtain a bond, which is part of the issue. And so, therefore, what do we do at that point when the owner can't obtain bond coverage for us to recoup any cost that's necessary for us to remediate the problem or the dangerous condition? But we are having discussions right now with the law department to figure out what the issue is.
Good afternoon, Councilwoman. My name is Scott McDyrick. I'm the director of the Emergency Services Division for the Department of License and Inspections. The process for us to demolish a property is not as quick as everybody would think. There's a due process that we have to go through, notifying the proper owner, making sure that we identify who the proper owner is, make sure they're notified. We also do mortgage checks because a mortgage holder of a property is also an owner. They have to be notified, and everybody has a right to due process. They also have a right to appeal our violation notices. They can go through the appeal process and either go to the L&I Review Board or the Board of Building Standards and appeal our violation notices. And we can't take action while that appeal is underway. So there's a lot of steps that we take to ensure that we're not violating someone's civil rights and that everybody has their due process. And that's not usually an easy task, weighing the civil rights of someone versus public safety. It's a very fine balance.
Are these state mandated due process or those ours locally?
I believe they're both, and federal guidelines and the civil rights statutes.
Mm-hmm. Is there any other means, you know, when you have a chronic violator, because many times, everybody knows our system. So everybody, as soon as we establish, we set the bar, somebody gains the system and makes it higher. What would be interesting for us to understand, because this is the stuff that's hard for us to explain to constituents, because if it's the house next door to you, you don't want to hear that. You don't want to hear due process. You don't want to hear, at what point is their legal rights supersede my public safety and that of my children? So for me, it's sort of like, what's legal, and what do we do for chronic folks? Does that clock start all over? Or is there, if we've taken someone to equity court and they're a chronic violator, how much of their rights do we continue to protect? Because, again, if every time we open a complaint, it's a new complaint, then they're working our clock.
Yeah, and that's a good point. A lot has to do with the judicial system. The judges play a big role, and the court system plays a big role in making those determinations. When we take a property to court, we seek to modify or address the situation. So if it's eminently dangerous and we need to demolish it, then we're asking the court system to look, this problem needs to be addressed immediately, Your Honor. Please allow us to demolish it.
But
if it's a chronic person.
But is your unit going to make sure that the clock doesn't start all over again? What I want to make sure out of this and in the compliance unit is that we don't start the clock over. If you had a ticket and it closed, you should not be allowed to start your clock again. And so part of what you have to look at is you already had an outstanding issue. This is not a new 30-day, 90-day, you get to come back to court and tell the judge I need a little bit more time. And if there's no law that prohibits us from doing that, that's going to take us a big step in the right direction of changing the mindset that it is cheaper to pay the fine than to do the right thing.
Yeah. Councilwoman, I think that certainly is a bigger conversation than and my department can answer, because it does require legal rights. If someone complies a violation, ultimately, if they fix the property, then the case is closed and we're in compliance and it does start over again.
Yeah, but sometimes we close a ticket because they got a permit to fix.
There are loopholes that we need to close. I agree with you there. Absolutely.
Right. There's a lot riding on this compliance unit. Mm-hmm. And so what I want to be sure is that you have the resources necessary to deal with it, and if there are regulatory or legal issues, legislative issues that we have to deal with in this council, I think everybody in this council wants to give you the tools. We just
Absolutely.
Need to know what they are.
Yeah. That's one of them, the legal issue that we have to face with closing those loopholes that allow people to escape and allow properties to deteriorate and start over while the community has to suffer. So that's one of the challenges. I think what council did with the legislation was extremely important, which does not allow deteriorated demolitions, permanent demolitions, to sit for extensive period of times. It gives us the opportunity to go in and close a permit down to address that property owner. That was a huge win for our department to be able to address that. It doesn't allow a demolition permit to sit for an extended period of time. We're now allowed to check on that site, and if it hasn't commenced in a certain period, we can close the permit. So those are some of the tools that has helped us, but there's more, and we should have a longer, bigger conversation about it.
Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Councilwoman. The Chair recognizes Councilman O'Brien.
Thank you, Mr. President. Commissioner, welcome.
How you doing, sir?
I think I can see you over there.
All right.
Can I just ask one question? I don't know if it's been asked before. How is the department ensuring the contractors have insurance and they're tax compliant?
Councilman, one of the things that we recognized as we went through this entire process, as we went through the Special Independent Commission and even before last June 5th, one of the challenges and the laws that was put on is to ensure that before any permit was issued, make sure that they have tax clearance and an insurance policy. Effective January 1st of this year, we put in a policy to ensure that happens. And what it's done is it allows us to get a first glance look at to make sure that someone is at least tax compliant through revenue department and they have the proper insurance at the time of permit. Now, someone can try to escape that system, and why the compliance unit is so important is that because they do the back end checks to ensure that someone doesn't get a permit and then allow their insurance to lapse the next day. They'll audit on the back end to ensure that while they're doing the work, which is the most important critical time, that they keep that insurance on the property. Because I can give you an example, and I certainly don't want to put our councilman on the spot, but one of the people that talked to his office last year came over to get a permit to submit his insurance. And the insurance had some information on it that didn't appear appropriate, and one of our lead, one of our people in customer care unit, in fact, I think it was Deputy Commissioner Fink's immediate assistant, called the insurance company and found that this person didn't have insurance at all, and he didn't have insurance since they had in the previous year of March 2013. Our records indicate that we issued 88 permits to that person who didn't have insurance, and so at its forefront, at least we're now catching people coming in the door. We know it's not a 100% foolproof system, but on the back end with a compliance unit, it now strengthens our ability to catch people in the beginning so they don't know what was required. And if they're fraudulently putting in, we take their and suspend their insurance and suspend their contractor's license. We put a fine, a hefty fine, ultimately take their license completely. And so now we're having people play by the rules like it should be. And so we don't have that issue as much as we had where people are allowed to just come in, show a certificate, and then get away with insurance. And then when they damage someone's property, the person has to sue. But who are they suing if they don't have an insurance company present? Those are the things that we're putting in place to change those issues and policies.
Thank you, Commissioner. That is a wonderful answer.
Thank you.
You don't have to, I introduced recently a piece of legislation calling for a vacant property task force to inspect all the vacant properties, starting with the commercial and industrial properties, primarily in Councilwoman Keona Sanchez's district. I don't know if you've had a chance to look at it. I just wanted to see if you had any thoughts And if you haven't had a chance to review it, you can come back to me at another point and discuss
sure.
it.
We certainly look forward to having that conversation. I think part of the issue with those large vacant commercials have to deal with that bond issue that the councilwoman talked about, as well as holding those type of property owners accountable for the condition of those buildings and ultimately putting them back into productive use. It's very difficult in the councilwoman's district because of the area's marketable ability in certain areas, and so that's a challenge, and so that's something I think that we should have a long-term conversation or a strategy to try to figure out how we're going to address while maintaining and stabilizing those buildings, because the issue of breaking into them and having crime and fire started is a big challenge here in the city of Philadelphia. It's one that's constantly costly to the city and to the citizens' taxpayers. So I'm looking forward to that conversation.
I welcome that conversation as well. There was another bill that we introduced calling for the certification and licensing of notarial fraud. It's in the legislation. I suggest that we put that under your purview, so no good deed goes unpunished. I want to give you more work to do. Do you have any thoughts on that?
I mean, it's an important issue. I think one that, again, needs to be discussed in detail as to what the concerns and what type of licensing would help mitigate those challenging, so that we can, I think the biggest part is that we have to have the tools to be able to enforce it. If it becomes an issue for our department or for us to address. And so I think we need to know the details as to what the requirements are, and we look forward to that as well.
Thank you, and we got right in under the wire. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilman. Real quick, Department of License Inspection, do you do CVNs for all vacant lots? Is that your department's responsibility, or is it some streets and some L&I?
Yeah, I think CLIP, the Community Life Improvement Program, is housed in our department. It's primarily the division department that is responsible for it. Although it's housed in our department, I think it's managed under the managing director's office.
Across the city?
Yes.
I don't have CLIP.
Yes, across the city. It's a citywide program.
Understand.
It's a citywide program.
I had
Mr.
NTI.
President.
I didn't get CLIP. It was a trade-off. If you were in the Northeast, you got CLIP. If you were down North Philly, you got NTI.
I walked into that one.
I just want to make sure. I'll come back later. Mm-hmm. That all of the code violations on vacant lots are done by CLIP.
Yes.
Which is a division within your department,
yes.
Citywide.
We have the majority. I mean, CLIP handles the majority. We have the capability of issuing a CVN, but the majority of them are done through the CLIP program.
What's the staff on CLIP?
I believe it's, do we know the staffing? I could get back to you on that, Council. I believe it's 12.
So 12 people are responsible for writing all of the violations on vacant lots across the city?
But the majority of them, because streets departments have sweep officers that can issue CVNs for a vacant lot, and those who have that authority can do so, but the majority of them, that's their focus of their program, is to address vacant lots.
All right. I like you, Commissioner, so do me a favor. Come back when you have a more defined answer.
Sure.
Kind of like all over the place on the response. I know, maybe because you're a little off guard. But you said, anyway, can you get back to me on that?
I can get back to you on the number of CLIP employees. Again, it's not directly managed by my department.
So you're saying, I'm just trying to understand it, because mm-hmm. I know L&I has the jurisdiction or the capability of writing violations, CVNs, violations on vacant lots. Am I correct?
Correct.
But you're telling me that your department does not do that. It's totally the, Beck, do you want to jump in? I'm just trying to understand how 12 people cover the entire city. And then we can talk to Councilman, explain to Councilman Johnson why he can't get CLIP down there. Yeah.
Rebecca Reinhart, Budget Director. I just wanted to add to what the Commissioner was saying. This isn't L&I's responsibility. CLIP is Tommy Conway's group? Right. Out of the Managing Director's office. Right. So that's probably why they maybe can't answer all the questions about that.
That's fine.
Okay.
I just want to, I'm just trying to get clarity
on
who could actually write the violations. And if it, and then the follow-up question, and Ms. Cutler is not here because we had a conversation with Ms. Cutler about some of the legislation that was enacted years ago on the ability to write violations on lots that were not non-compliant, similar to the way we write violations in real time on people who haven't shoveled their sidewalks off 6 hours after the snow is over, or you didn't take your trash in at a particular time, you immediately get you immediately get violations, but yet on these vacant lots you're allowed like 30, 60 days to comply. And I'm just trying to
I'm not sure what the rules are, but we can definitely I can talk to Rhina and Tommy and get you a response back if that works.
All right, yeah, I mean she took the list of and I should have asked her when she was here earlier, but I thought she so Ellen I is under Deputy Greenberg?
That's correct.
Okay, I get confused.
No, that's interesting.
Streets is under Ms. Cutler.
That's correct.
All right. Okay. I'm from the old school, you know. Everything was under the managing director. Yeah.
I'll go to them and get you the response. Does that work? And then you don't have to worry about who's under who.
Yeah, I saw her here, and I was assuming that she was going to be here today because I had a question about the. Okay. All right. Well, I'll wait.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Bass.
Thank you, Mr. President. Rebecca, before you go back. Rebecca. Before you go back.
Can't speak out.
She's going to Philly's game? Before you go, I just wanted to say, just you know, in the dialogue with the Council President just a moment ago, it seems as if some of the agencies, and they all do a great job, but it does seem that it's a little confusing and it's a little redundant, and it doesn't necessarily fit in a way I think that makes sense to most of us. Maybe in, you know, to the administration, you know, it makes perfect sense, but it doesn't really seem to be a neat fit for most of us in terms of do you call CLIP or do you call sweeps or do you call, you know, just L&I or do you call the streets department or, you know, do you call the MDO or, you know, it just seems to be a little bit all over the place. What'd you say?
I said call Ghostbusters.
So it's all over. And so, you know, just trying to find a way to simplify might also be an opportunity to save money. I just wanted to state that, and I don't know if you want to comment.
Okay. I mean, I think that, of course, it's easy for the administration to say we understand who's doing what and that we're monitoring redundancy, but to your point, if it's not clear to you, then we obviously have to work on making it clear.
And I think it's, you know, it's not just me. I think, you know, like there's a lot of people who don't seem to know, whether it's, you know, me or whether it's the general public in terms of, you know, do you know about CLIP? Do you know about sweeps? Do you know about, and we do a lot of community meetings and we bring, you know, these folks out and they, you know, give a great presentation, but I don't know that people recognize that there are all these different points of contact. And so, you know, I'm just making the point that I think if it was in under one jurisdiction, so under L&I, for example, it just might be a little bit easier, a little bit more streamlined in terms of effectiveness, mm-hmm. is my thought.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So just wanted to mention that. Also, I had a question on the demolition work that's done by the contractors and when we have, because I know we've talked about this in the past and it seems like it's gotten better, but we still get complaints from contractors who demolish a house, let's say a house is between two other existing structures, and the damage that's done by the contractor and then the difficulty in terms of the follow-up and getting that same contractor to come out and do the repairs for the damage that they've done to the other properties.
Yeah. Yes, Councilwoman. The requirement under our master demolition program is that they have to carry a bond to certify their work in case there is those situations that come up. They're required to repair, and if they don't repair, then we go after their bond to make the necessary repairs to a property owner of a demolition property that's been demolished. And so the process is through our inspection of that property. We make sure that the foundation is checked, any of the framing inspection from any loose joists properly patched, and that there's a process to ensure that the house next door is not leaking as well. So those are some of the things. Now, those things do come up
yes.
well after the demolition
yes.
has completed. Mm-hmm. And so we certainly want to make sure that the public understands that there is a process for them to be able to address that. We certainly give it to our risk management division to mm-hmm. make sure that we go after the contractor's bond to ensure that they repair if they don't willingly come back to repair it on their own and any damages.
In general, how many contractors would you say have we had, has this been a problem with in terms of having to go after their bond? And if it is, you know, if it's happened, you know, on more than one occasion with a particular contractor, are they then sort of flagged? Do we do any sort of flagging of that contractor to say this isn't someone who kind of stands by their work or completes the job by going back out and making sure everything is correct?
Yeah, we do get a number. I don't have that with me right now. We get a number of complaints from property owners stating that their properties have suffered some kind of damage demolition project. And I can go back and get you the calls that we've received on that and the responses
okay.
that we've had is that well. I just don't have that right now.
Okay. So if we could get an idea of, you know, how often this occurs mm-hmm. Out of the total number of demolitions, how many complaints we get in terms of damage, and also for the contractors who do go back or who don't go back, you know, do we have to go through the bond, through their bond process to actually pay to get the work done? And is there a process to flag those particular contractors who don't do what they, you know, contractually agree to do?
Yes, so. I'll get you that information.
Thank you so much.
Yes.
I'll come back.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilman Squilla.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, guys, for being here. My question is a little different in that the process for permitting. We see that when we talk to developers or even people to do it themselves, a lot of them would rather risk the chance of getting caught than to go out and get a permit. And therefore, when they don't do it, our mechanism for finding them for doing work without a permit. Is there anything that we could do now? Like, we see it all the time. People start work without a permit, then they get caught and they go get one. Is there something where we could do and create a fine for people who start work without permits?
I certainly defer to Deputy Commissioner Mike Fink, who's been here for 30 years, who knows what the procedures were. But one of the things that we've done is to create a task force to be able to identify those people and to address them immediately to issue stop work orders. And anyone in violation of a stop work order under the new regulations can be fined $500 per day per incident. So the risk now is greater than the reward for someone to try to address it. But I believe that Deputy Commissioner Fink can tell you what the immediate penalty is for someone who we catch, and then they try to go get a permit. So.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Councilman. The code now allows us to apply what we call a reinspection fee, which is equal to the permit fee. So if they had started work on a very large project, then their permit fee is essentially doubled. And if it's a small homeowner project, it's still doubled, but it's much less of an impact. We issue stop work orders when we find work going on without a permit. And the recent legislation from council related to the demolition issue allows us now to issue $500 CVNs to a contractor who violates a stop work order. So those are the current penalties that are on the books for working without a permit.
Well, let me just get that clear. So if they continue to work after you catch them, they get a fine. But how about when you catch them for working without a permit? Is that when the reinspection fee comes in?
Yes, sir. When they come in, the work is stopped. When they come in to apply and actually get their permit, the fee for that permit is doubled.
Okay. Because that, I mean, I'm a big proponent of making the actual permits as reasonable as possible to encourage people to get permits so we know who's doing work. Everybody out there said, listen, it's not worth the $50 not to do it. Let's go pull a permit. But when the permit prices start to get too high, these contractors, especially the little guys out there, say, you know what, let's take a chance. Let's not go out there. Let's not pull the permit. They might never catch us because they're busy. They don't have enough inspectors, whatever the thing is. So I think we need to really encourage the process of getting a permit easily as far as the cost of it, but then maybe increasing the fines for the people who start work without permits or even after the stop work order, $500 fine's good, but there's really the only cost right now is maybe an extra $50 if you get caught. And I think they're still willing to take that chance. So I think maybe we should look at the fine, heavier fine for people who continue to work and do this process, because you talk to developers all the time, especially guys on these small projects, it's really hard to catch them. And I think that if we could make it reasonable, the actual permits and the licensing, so everybody gets licenses, and we're talking about this with special assembly licenses and things, you make them reasonable, everybody goes and gets them. Then we know everybody has them, then we could follow up on them. But right now, it's just the mentality of the people out there is they could still beat the system. Now, LNI has got a lot stronger since some of the new legislation through council and some of the new inspections. And I know you guys are still short-staffed to be able to get out there to all the sites. There's going to be a lot of building, not only in my district, but throughout the city of Philadelphia within the next year and so. So your work's going to be endless. And if we can make it easier for them to get permits, or at least reasonable enough to get permits, and then maybe double the cost of the fine for people who start work without permits, or even the work order, like you said, once that stop order's there and they get caught, then it's a $500 fine. But that'll send a message to these guys, you got to pull a permit. And then what we need to do is the process of getting the permit has to be faster. We need to somehow be able to streamline, whether it's an online process of the people to be able to do a quick tax certification to necessary. We can't have people willing to do construction and do the right thing, wait 30, 60, 90 days to get a permit. So is there something in now in the process to make that happen?
When it comes to permits for residential properties for single families, we streamlined the process greatly in the last couple of years by coming up with easy permit standards. So you don't need to pay for an architect or anyone to draw up a set of plans, and we do not need to do a plan review. We established the code requirements because they're limited in nature for a single family. We put them on a sheet of paper, and that's what you follow as part of your permit. So for single families, we try to assist people in getting their permits for the small projects, the interior renovations, the decks, and things like that. You're correct that we need to have the information technology capabilities to do online applications, to do an automatic check of someone's tax status. Those are the things that we are planning with our Eclipse effort. So yes, we understand that we've needed those for a while, and we plan to implement those.
Is there a timeline, though? Are you projecting a timeline when we could get to that point or not at this time? It's just too early to know.
Yes, we're about a year away for full implementation, for the first phase of implementation of Project Eclipse, with the expectation of the program by the end of 2015. So we're about a year away from having all of those services, not just online permitting, but some other services that's going to help us do our job smarter, quicker, faster. About 2 years. We're in the process of building that now.
Okay. I'll come back, but thank you very much. Thank you for your answers.
Thank you. Chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. And as I listened to the round of questioning from my colleagues, all of it was insightful. But what is really good, Mr. President, is that a lot of the things that came out of those recommendations, they're actually starting to do. And what is encouraging over the 18-month window that we gave you, you didn't wait. So in the case of the contractor who came back in shock and awe, saying, wait a minute, they're actually checking this stuff, and came running to our office saying, can you help? No. You can help yourself by going to get out the appropriate licenses and things like that. What it shows is that we often do good work here, but it takes the department's willingness to actually implement it. And so, you know, whether you do good work over here, it can sit on a shelf as recommendations and never get implemented. So we want to thank you and your staff for actually taking to heart. We did not, my staffer, Stacy Graham, who worked primarily on that report, did not ever have to pull teeth to get information from you guys, which made the process, it was a willingness to work and implement this, Mr. President. So thank you for your swift action of pulling together a committee, and actually it just goes to show that sometimes government works best when it works together.
Couldn't have happened without your great chairmanship, sir.
And you took away my summer, is what you did.
Absolutely.
So a couple of quick questions. You're getting ready, on the note of technology, you're getting ready to have handhelds, and I understand you have a kiosk in the concourse to get some of those permits to Councilman Squilla's question a lot easier.
Yeah, the kiosk allows them to obtain their tax clearance and to get an insurance certificate faxed right to the downstairs so they don't have to leave and come back. And so we wanted to make sure we provided good customer service because we knew it was a policy change. And so we set up computer systems that allow people to have access to that information instantaneously.
And I thought you would mention that to Councilman Schooler's question, so I figured I'd give you an assist.
I certainly appreciate that, Councilman.
Okay. The second one was there was a recommendation to Councilwoman Bass's point about reporting, and also Council President Clark, about reporting responsibilities. And one of our recommendations, which we felt was a conflict, was that L&I reported to the economic development lords and beings as opposed to the public safety folk. And have you taken that recommendation and implemented it yet? I'm looking at, has that happened?
No, not as of yet. I think we're in this same structure. But I can again tell you again that Deputy Mayor Alan Greenberger, myself, Everett Gillison, meet very frequently on all safety-related issues. Once a week, we have a meeting to discuss all issues related to L&I, specifically those of public safety. But that structure has not changed.
That's one of the 75 recommendations that I think is a critical one, because yes, there are gravity pulls that say we want to build this building quicker, faster, and move it through the process. But at the end of the day, if we have to err, we need to err not on the side of swiftness, but on the side of safety. And so I think the demolition committee felt strongly that it should report to someone who has that in mind, as opposed to how to change our skyline. And that's important. Those are important priorities. But at the end of the day, that person walking under that scaffolding wants to know that somebody cares not about profit, but about protection. And at the end of the day, that's the one I mentioned. 95% of what we wrote, we agreed on, and some of it we kind of wrestled with. But that's one we are going to kind of look to for that change.
I understand.
I just want to make sure Rebecca understands. Okay, all right. So one other thing, for buildings above four stories, I believe it is, safety plans are now required. And can you talk about that process and change now?
Sure. The new requirements, the mayor's executive order after June 5th tragedy and then codified in the legislation requires site safety plans and work schedules to be presented and approved by the department by a competent person. And this can be equivalent to a professional engineer who has the experience to be able to show that they have the ability to say this is the proper way to demolish a building of this size, scope, and nature. So that has to be submitted at the permit application, and that's why the review process takes 20 days and not an over-the-counter permit where someone has just issued a demolition permit as a result. So that's the things that we're looking at in detail with our qualified staff right now. During the inspection process as well, the inspector takes the site safety plan that's been approved by the department and reviews it with the contractor at the initial point of the job and throughout each phase of development according to the work schedule.
So, Mr. President, if site safety plans are filed, it's public information, and then followed, you know, you can't take the party wall out first because it's expedient to do. No, you have to take it down from the top, one floor at a time, through a process that everybody from a layperson to an engineer can understand. And that's why that recommendation was so critical. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you. Again, thank you for a great job. Chair recognizes Councilwoman, hold on 1 second, one quick question, I'm sorry. Councilwoman, 1 second. Who's responsible? I just had a flashback about a walk around during Saturday's cleanup. Who's responsible for dead trees in alleyways overhanging that sit on vacant property?
The property owner is responsible for any...
Well, that's why I said vacant property.
Yeah, like, vacant property.
More likely the property owner is like...
If it's a viable property owner, it's the property owner. Other than that, if it's an imminently dangerous situation, we take action to have it mitigated and resolved on private property. On private property. So if it's not on the curb line, if it's on the curb line, it's Parks and Recreation Department, it's on private property, we're responsible for overseeing that the problem gets addressed.
Okay. So in my walk around Saturday, because I know all the council members were walking around neighborhoods, in particular section where there was a significant amount of vacancy, all up and down the rears of properties, you had these big trees, probably 50, 70 years old, who knows, some of them struck by lightning or whatever, by the sheer weight, broken off on individuals' properties that were actually occupied. One, we actually saw that it knocked down the chimney of an occupied property. I'm not going to give it because I don't want you to go out there and close the lady down, kick the lady out of the house because of carbon monoxide poisoning, but, you know, this a little later. You're saying that if that information is forwarded to your department, then when you cannot find the viable property owner, which I know you won't be able to, it is ultimately responsibility of the city to abate that particular nuisance.
If it's imminently dangerous, yes, that's correct.
All right, okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You're welcome.
You may want to ask for additional revenues in your budget because I anticipate that based on that statement, there's going to be a whole lot of requests asking you to deal with trees because it's a real big problem in a lot of these communities. All right, thank you. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Tasco. I'm sorry, I had to get that in.
I looked at your request for an increase for your budget. Is that an adequate enough increase for you to, I know you spell out here what you need to have that those dollars for, but would there be something else that you would like to see in your budget that you really need, and is it really, do you really have enough money to run your department adequately enough? I've asked this question ever since I've been on council, because mm-hmm. I always believe that L&I is one of the most important, if not the most important, department in the city, as you can see all the responsibility you have for different issues. And I never thought it had enough money to facilitate getting things done in a way that would be satisfactory. So I'm asking you, is this enough? You have to say no, but what would be an adequate amount that you might need?
I think what the budget, Councilwoman, reflects is a conscious attempt to provide greater oversight on dangerous construction sites. I think where we need to have a larger conversation, I think what was put in the paper today in regards to a strategy to address vacant properties has been a constant challenge for our department. So if there was an area that we would want to take a look at in terms of resource allocation, it certainly would be an area of dealing with vacant properties. That's where our biggest challenge and concerns right now are. And that encompasses not just additional
monies to demolish, but looking at legal support, looking at making sure that as we discuss the court time to be able to address properties before they get in that condition. So we need to look at an entire strategy to address that and then look at the resource allocation to get the job done in that area. But if there was an area that we needed to look at, it certainly would be that. Dealing with large vacants is expensive to demolish and to address. As I stated earlier, the church that we're demolishing on North 9th Street cost $962,000. That would cover about eight or nine of them if we was to use my entire demolition budget right now. So it's a challenge to address the vacant properties here in the city of Philadelphia.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Reynolds Brown.
President, recognizing that given the demands of your office, adequate dollars are not there. And so given that reality, what is the interface and or connectedness with public property when it comes to properties deemed imminently dangerous? What kind of communications protocols exist between your two departments?
When we identify a property that's owned by a public agency, I just want to clarify. The protocol is even with this budget, we're able to provide additional inspections. I want to highlight that as well. This budget allows our inspectors to look at those buildings that were either unsafe or imminently dangerous on a much higher ratio than what we normally would do. When we go out and reinspect properties and identify the owner, if it's a public property, we notify the department as soon as possible for permission to address. Mm-hmm. Either if it's an unsafe, it's their responsibility to make safe. If it's an ID property, then we'll take the action and then seek reimbursement. But for the Department of Public Property, since it's a city agency, mm-hmm. the department assumes that responsibility within its own budget because it's the same funds that we use to remediate.
So then that drives the follow-up question, and we will have to access a public property. What is in their system? Would they have their own self-triggers of their own properties owned by public property that fall under imminently dangerous?
That's a question for public property. Mm-hmm. That's correct. Our side of it is that if we're out doing proactive inspections and it happens to be a property, once we identify who that owner is, if it happens to be a city agency or a public agency, mm-hmm. then we notify them through a memo, a direct to say, here are the list of properties that we've identified that are ID. And then they give us authorization to say, take it down and take whatever action necessary to make it safe.
So then is it fair to say then that there are no standard, what I call SOP, standard operating procedures in place where L&I and public property on a regular basis, for whatever regular means, shares information on the status or the grade, G-R-A-D-E, of their buildings? So that the call doesn't only happen when there is a potential crisis, but there's some regular communication between the two departments on the status of the building.
There is a larger strategy amongst a number of departments that look at all vacants and to determine what to do with them, how to move them to the sheriff's cell, and how to rid them. So it is that's a monthly meeting that continuously happens between not only public property and L&I, but through RDA, PRA, and those departments that talk about strategy issues on what to do with our land that we own here in the city of Philadelphia.
Land disposition. So is that was that another recommendation of the committee, or was that underway prior to the work of the committee last summer?
That was underway prior to the committee last summer.
And so do you expect some kind of rollout and announcement of sorts of what this strategic plan is going to be?
I'm sure that there is going to be discussions on where it's at. I can't give you all of that detail right now, and I can follow up for you, Councilwoman.
Because I'm sure district council members would be deeply interested in that.
Indeed.
Okay.
I will follow up.
Speaking on the issue of proactive, know that looking now at young people in the dawn of their lives, know that we at the urging of your staff are working carefully to craft amendments that will properly address the concerns around being proactive when it comes to child care inspections versus reactive. and reactive period, so that we can minimize stories where young people are walking off because of whatever's not in place around annual inspections. So we're working to craft those amendments. I want to put that on the record so that you are aware of that.
Yeah, I look forward to working with your office as well.
Now to a constituent matter. On page one of your testimony, you stated that the department is requesting an increase for Class 100 funds for the addition of a number of staff, including 5 service representatives, mm-hmm. to provide additional support. You also state requesting an increase in Class 200 to fund a support to support a community outreach program. I'll be interested in knowing what that public education piece looks like. How can they help LNI by engaging 311? And here's the example, or the support case. A few weeks ago, one of my constituents' service reps, or your constituent service, no, mine, dealt with a case where our office reported a vacant property with falling debris to 311. We received the request number, and the request was listed as completed within 7 days. However, the request was closed because an inspector completed the initial inspection, although the case needed several subsequent additional steps on that particular property. So the question is, do constituents have a way to track a case that's been registered? How and can do constituents receive updates on cases that require more than one step for completion?
Certainly, Councilwoman, that is certainly a big challenge to be able to respond back to people to let them know something is happening with that property. One way, 311 is working on a customer response management program, a new system to provide better data to the public in terms of response times and what the department has done or is doing. Uh-huh. In our own department, we renovated, or I guess the word is recrafted, and rebuilt our new website to provide that data in real time. So when there's a property case that's open and they want to know what's going on with that property, whether it's at first inspection, second inspection, sent to court, you can go on our website by putting the property address in, and it'll tell you the complete history of violations. It'll
and
tell you at which stage it is, at level it's at, and then it'll tell you to whether it's been in court or it's been resolved.
Gotcha.
That's how you can get the detailed information much further than just calling 311 and checking their system.
I see.
And that's www.phila.gov/li.
Okay.
That's our website address.
Okay, so it goes to Councilman Bass' question or concern, this notion of educating, informing citizens just about the, it's tough for us as members of council, so I can only imagine what it is for lay people to fully understand the complexity of your department. Okay, mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank
You're
you,
welcome.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Bass.
Thank you. Just a couple of questions. You have gave us a chart on page 3, I think it was, which really gave us what I thought was a really good breakdown in terms of what the performance measures were and how they actually, how you quantified all of the work that you're doing. And I'm wondering, is it possible to get that broken down by council district?
Oh, sure.
That
yes,
would be great.
We will work to do that. We do that for the demolitions and the properties. We certainly will do that as well for that. It may take a little time for us to break them down, but we can get that information for you by district inspector. We'll do it by district office.
That would
district.
Be great, so that we know if, so for example, let's see, if we look at our goal for this year is 1,400 for the total number of properties cleaned and sealed, it will be great to see how that's distributed. What does that number look like in the 8th district as opposed to, the 1st district and so on?
Yes, we certainly can get you that information.
That will be great. Mm-hmm. And also, with the 26 new inspectors, can you tell us, give us an idea in terms of what that will translate to in terms of efficiency for your office?
Sure. They'll primarily be assigned to both the Emergency Services Unit and the Compliance Division. Ultimately, it'll lead to a 71% increase in reinspections of dangerous properties, which I talked about earlier. Mm-hmm. We also will look at increasing our construction site task force numbers by 150%. We currently have 6 inspectors who perform 4,000 inspections and issue 1,600 violations for contractors who didn't or weren't in compliance on a construction site. And to Councilman Squealer's point earlier, the greater the oversight, the less problems that we're going to have. I think the fines are one thing, but the other part is that we have to have people out there who are proactively checking mm-hmm. on construction sites to ensure that they're following the rules in the first place and then using those fines for those who are not. So we have made progress, and I think with the additional inspectors that you'll have, you'll see even more. My office has been getting inundated with complaints from developers to saying that we're picking on them, but unfortunately, for the benefit of public safety, is something that's well overdue.
Okay, very mm-hmm. good, very good. And also, one other quick question. I know Councilman O asked earlier in terms of the total demolition budget, and you have about $3.4 million left for the remainder of the fiscal year. It seems like there's a lot left. There's only a couple of months left to go before the end of the year, and there's certainly no shortage of things to do. Mm-hmm. Do you think that that's a lot to be left, or is this normally the way it goes, or?
Well, normally we'll have it at the beginning of the fiscal year. Because of some of the things that I mentioned earlier, we had to take down that big church, which mm-hmm. ate up a lot of our funding. Mm-hmm. We were inundated with a lot of requests for the concern after the June 5th tragedy and also the winter conditions. We used up that demolition fund and at a much faster rate. And then we required a mid-year transfer. And so we just received the transfer. But we certainly are going to package those properties up and to have them bid out before the end of the fiscal year so we don't see any anticipation of losing any of that funding that was designated to our department.
So it's about on track, you would say?
Yes. We're under the pressure to address them. But we have larger buildings that we certainly will use that funding to address. We gave you an average of what it costs for a single-family residential mm-hmm. two-story property, mm-hmm. but we have some properties in both in your district and north of Philadelphia and West mm-hmm. Philadelphia that are 3 or more stories that need to be addressed as well, and we'll certainly utilize that funding and resources for that.
Okay, very good. Thank you. And lastly, I just wanted to say, you know, I really do appreciate working with your office because, you know, as so many other folks have said here, you're always accessible. We can always get an answer. And I do think that that's, you know, it's different from what I experienced in the past. So I just really wanted to say how much I appreciate being able to pick up the phone and actually get an answer. Or, you know, I'll get back to you and you actually do, you know, you actually do call back and give us the information that we're looking for. So I really just wanted to say on record that I appreciate that.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilman Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. President. Calling, I guess, on this question, a different direction than dealing with vacant land and demolition and demolition of properties, but it's a prelude to a hearing that Councilman Curtis Jones will be hosting and legislation I will be exploring regarding the safety of fire stairways and our city's protocol criteria in addressing those buildings that have fire escapes. And so my question is, one, what is our criteria and protocol in addressing fire escapes? Two, when a resident, a tenant, landlord, or if someone else reports to LNI that a property has a faulty fire escape, what is the process? And then in light of the incident that took place in my councilmatic district with the loss of life of an individual and someone else being hurt standing on a fire escape, I know we're going to address this in the hearing, but I just want to get an overview of where we're at. You're professional, and I know we talked briefly about it, you're professional expert opinion on how you think it should be addressed and moving forward.
Sure. I can tell you about the current process in which our department gets involved. Stairways and fire cases and fire escapes are the responsibility of the property owner to maintain in accordance with the property maintenance code and the fire code. If we receive a complaint, it's complaint driven, so if we receive a complaint, we will perform a visual inspection with our emergency services unit to determine the structure or condition. But our staff does not have the technical skills to be able to say if it has certain load-bearing capacities. And so while it may look safe from a visual inspection, which our inspectors will do, only a certified engineer has that capability to say whether something can withstand certain weight loads or if it's safe from its structural appearance. Our department will come out and look at things to see if there are broken fixtures, if there are steps missing, if the railing is loose. Those things will require our department. But when you talk about the high level skill needed to determine whether it's completely safe to hold people in the event of an emergency, you're certainly going to have someone who has a higher skill level to be able to do that type of assessment. And currently that is a requirement of a structural engineer.
Receive those type of complaints. Mm-hmm. So what happens? Do y'all contract with an outside professional engineer to actually come in and do the assessment?
Just like we do with a dangerous building, we'll order it unsafe and order an engineer's report. That's the responsibility of a property owner. So a property owner will have to, in the situation following the tragedy, is exactly what we've done. We noticed that there were obvious apparent structural conditions, but to repair it in order where it's fully functional again, they had to submit an engineer's report to say, this is what steps need to be taken to make that structure now safe and usable again, which is current intent. So that's the type of process that we would need to have in place to ensure that they're safe in general before they get into a deteriorated state.
And last thing, how often do landlords renew their rental license? And also, when we do bring in the outside professional engineer, what companies do we contract with to bring in a professional engineer to say, let's review this building, we deem it safe or unsafe?
Okay. We do an annual rental registration. People call it a license, but it's actually a registration where they have a certificate from the department that says they're zoned to be able to rent this property in its condition, whether it's a two-unit, three-unit, six-unit, whatever the number of units is. The rental registration license shows them what they can do legally. When it comes down to providing engineers' reports, those usually fall on the responsibility of the property owner to select. We don't recommend. Yeah, we don't recommend because ultimately we assume the liability if we do so. So therefore, it's up to the property owner to get their own engineer and bring it to our attention. And they have to be certified by the state.
Good, Councilman. Good. Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you. Chair recognizes Councilman O.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. My light turned off by itself, so it's taken me a long time to get to that second part of that, but I hope you remember. Anyway, we were talking about the fire remediation, and you had said that, you know, when the home is insured by a private insurer, that's taken care of, not at city cost. What about when the property is not covered by insurance? That would be paid for by the city. Is that correct?
If we took any action to demolish it, we don't repair, but we demolish. If we had to make it safe by taking down any part or all of the structure, then it falls on the city's budget, taxpayer dollars, yes.
And do we in any way recoup any of that money?
Only if the property is leaned and sent either to sheriff's sale, and then after all debts are paid, then the lien process is considered to reimburse the city. So that is a law department can be able to tell you in detail how effective the lien process is and us recouping the dollars that are owed from work that we've done.
Okay, so the law department would have that, not your department.
Yeah, once the work is done, we submit a bill, and once the bill is not paid, it turns into a lien against the property. And at that point, it becomes another department's responsibility for collecting that.
Okay, thank you. So currently there are 13 contractors for doing the clean and seal, the demolition?
No, clean and seal is done in-house.
In-house,
we have 32 clean and seal staff members who go out and seal up vacant properties. Only the demolition work currently is done by contractors.
And that is put out to bid. Is that how they're selected?
That's correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And so when do you put these out to bid? Like the beginning of every fiscal year or periodically?
Right before the beginning of the fiscal year, they have to go through an intense certification process. That involves a combination of law department, procurement, and our department. And part of those is to look at their qualifications, to make sure that they're bonded and insured, and to make sure that they're they're tax compliant. Those are some of the things that they're looking at, and their level of experience in performing these type of projects in the city before they're then brought on as a contractor for the year, for the fiscal year. So it's done prior to the fiscal year.
What about fire remediation? Are they also certified and bonded and selected, or is it kind of whoever shows up at the fire first come, first serve?
The only ones that could perform work ordered by the city is the ones that have been registered on our master demolition program. So when we're coming in and we're called out on a fire, we do a curbside bid of those 13 contractors. Notices are sent out to ask them to bid on that job, and then they bid right at the curb of who gets it right there. So it's not any contractor can come up. It has to be on that registered list.
One of those 13?
Yes, that's correct.
And so finally, then, I'm looking at the, the contracts, and I see that for the MWDBE participation that there was two contractors, one for $893,000 and one for $111,000. So basically about $1 million of the $10 million went to a minority woman disadvantaged business. Is that correct?
Yes, but there is... Those are the ones I believe that are OEO certified.
Okay.
But if you include the minority contractor who has a significant amount of the funding, our numbers were at 21%. If you include that minority contractor, it goes up to 40%. But we are certainly trying to work with him to get him OEO certified so that we can greatly exceed our number as we have done in years past.
Okay. Thank you very much. I noticed that one of them does not appear to be, based on its name, I don't want to say the name, but Blank Home Repair. They don't seem to be like a big company, which I think is very encouraging that modest-sized businesses can also bid. Mm-hmm. Is that correct, or is that just a name that's misleading? It's really a huge corporation with, like, it sounds like a little small business.
Most of our residential contractors are small franchises and small companies. Independent contractors. They're the majority of them because the bigger firms, it's hard for them to compete that way.
Right. I'll have one last question, Mr. President. How do you get the word out? Now, how do you distribute? I think it's great this business can bid and go through the certification process and get bonded and all that. Is the word generally put out so that other businesses can bid as well?
I believe it's announced through normal procurement procedures, which may not always reach everyone as an advertisement would, and I think that's something that we want to consider. We can have a conversation.
I'll bring it up with procurement. Thank you very much, Commissioner.
Absolutely. Thank you, Councilman. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. Very briefly, by way of OSHA training, you mentioned that you were assuring that included in, and we had some lively discussions about the value of OSHA training versus what the higher standard, which I sense is the higher standard that your staff have, and that was fairly received. But also, the flip side of that was making sure that contractors and their respective staffs had OSHA-trained individuals on their site, and I wanted to know, How's that going? And in addition, I think the standard of state safety in Philadelphia is creating a cottage industry where a trained workforce, whether it's in the union halls or the barbershops, actually are sought after to have this type of training. And I know we talked about the public schools being a source of that type of training, and I wanted to know how we were doing in that outreach effort. And I noticed we put a little money aside for that, so I particularly wanted to know how that was going.
Well, individually, I think that all of our inspectors will have that level of training in this fiscal year. So that is our goal, to ensure that they have at least an OSHA 30 level training. And I know that there was also a point in legislation that a percentage of them will receive OSHA 500 training as well. And so we certainly are looking forward to that. As far as the public is concerned, we still need to have a discussion on how we implement that for a citywide program. Certainly don't think our department internal staff has the capability of providing those trainings, but I think that a contracted agency might be able to, and so we should look at someone who has that capability of doing that type of training to be able to provide that.
In addition, but what I was really talking about was where we can go to outlets that provide it. I know the unions give that training to, many of them do, to their membership, but I was also saying for the average person, where can they go get the OSHA training? I know it's online, but I wanted it inculcated into the curriculum. For example, Overbrook High School, my alma mater, has a home repair program that is a part of their curriculum. In so, they're doing OSHA training for the young people so that, yes, they know how to put up sheetrock, drywall, stud out a room, but they also know how to do it safely. And that certification will have a value in the labor force that we want to see incorporated. So whether they're you're contracting with a private entity to teach Joe and Janie contractor how to get OSHA certified, or whether you're working with the public school system to put it in some of their shop training, I want to know how you guys are moving on that.
Yeah, we haven't had much progress on that to date, Councilman, and that's something that we will certainly look at. We certainly focused on the critical points of the legislation that we needed to put in place immediately, but we certainly want to have a long-term plan to be able to provide that. I don't have one right now.
Okay, I want to suggest to you Randolph Skills Center in the 4th District. Overbrook High School in the 4th District is available and waiting for you to take care of that.
Duly noted. I will certainly
in Dobbins,
take that in.
As well as Dobbins in the 5th District as well. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
And Bach, right? And Bach too, right, Councilman?
We had Bach until it was merged with South Philadelphia High School.
Bring it back.
It's unfortunate because I am a machinist by trade, but yeah.
Okay. Good, Councilman? You good? Yeah, thank you. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Brown.
Okay. So the committee did the work, important work last year. Recommendations were submitted. Some have been acted upon. On page one of your testimony, you state that you cooperated with the Inspector General's Office, the Law Department, the Grand Jury, the Comptroller's Office, and the Mayor's Special Independent Advisory Commission. You state also that you have not received any feedback from those departments. So with that said, does that still exist today, that you have not received feedback from those departments? And have they informed you that any recommendations from those departments who have different levels of responsibility and authority, have they informed you whether or not they'll be sending you recommendations?
Yes, Councilwoman. The controller's audit is still pending. They're still conducting an audit of our department's demolition practices and construction practices. I'm sure that we will hear from the controller's office real soon on the outcome of their investigation. The special independent advisory commission's recommendations are due by July 1st.
Oh, okay.
And so we will also hear what the outcomes of those recommendations are as well. grand juries are pending and they continue on for long periods of time. And so at some point, we may hear from the recommendations from the grand jury as well. So those are the areas that will, those are ongoing matters that will provide recommendations in the near future.
Mm-hmm. Okay. According to LNI, so did we address this already? So is there a professional national association of professionals in your business where folks come together to examine, learn about best practices for cities that are similarly situated, where we have X number of imminently dangerous buildings?
I think there are national, federal, state, and local organizations that we're affiliated with in the city. Deputy Commissioner Fink and Maynard can talk to about the, some of the affiliations that they currently attend on behalf of the department. It's the GBCA, General Builders and Contractors Association. There is the BOMA. And I'll let Michael, Deputy Commissioner Mike Maynard talk about BOMA and the BIA, which is the Building Industry Association. Those are local kind of, industry organizations that frequently talk about best practices.
Yes, and that's exactly where I'm getting to. Now, I'm familiar with BOMA because we work closely with them on our green building bill and know well of the good work of BIA. And that's actually what I'm getting to. Mm-hmm. What takeaways? So you attend a national meeting of municipal professionals, and what takeaways exist that we have not been able to implement because of lack of dollars? What best practices are still hanging, but we can't grab them because of inadequate funding? That's exactly what I'm getting to.
Great. And one of the things also on a national level and an international level, the ICC, which is the International Code Council, in which both members that I stated earlier, Deputy Commissioners Fink and Maynard are members are part of, that is the process for how codes are established and developed. Uh-huh. And so those best practices usually formulate at that level across the entire world. And so each year they have an annual convention in which we attend to talk about upcoming issues in the construction industry, not just demolition, but the entire construction industry as a whole, to talk about code development and how they become established and become into municipal law. So I don't know the hottest topics lately, but I will defer to Deputy Commissioners Fink and Maynard to talk briefly about those associations and the fruits of their labor from attending those conferences as well.
Let me have two or three that you made a difference for who you are as a professional and that you're able to take and put in place or execute within the department.
Okay, on the state level, we also belong to PHRC, and what they do, that's affiliated with Penn State University.
Sure, it's my alma mater.
Okay, we had this past, I guess it was about a month and a half ago, our engineering staff, Betsy Baldwin and Mick Altmeyer, went up there and gave a presentation on infill construction, and they taught Penn State some of the issues that we deal with infill construction and some of the codes, how they impede our infill construction. Mm-hmm. So they're also an advisory to the State Commission. So some of those things may get implemented to make it easier to do infill construction. And that's on the state level. On the national level, both Mike Fink, I, and many of our inspectors belong to the International Code Council. I'm on the Major Jurisdiction Steering Committee. And if you go on iccsafe.org, you'll see our presentation for our vacant strategy, which is shared internationally. I also belong to, I'm the chairman of the Global Membership Council. And this past year, we had inspectors come from Abu Dhabi to see our best practices.
Really? That's more district. Councilman Jones wants to know what district you live in.
I live in the 4th District. And a graduate of Frankfurt High School. So there are some of the things that we take away. When when issues occur, we call other jurisdictions within the major jurisdictions committee, hey, what do you do here, what do you do here? But I'd like to say that a lot of jurisdictions call us. And a lot of jurisdictions from around the world call us.
Wow.
We field calls from Japan, Taiwan, Abu Dhabi, of course, who just adopted the international codes. So
okay.
That's how we do nationally and internationally.
Okay. Well, the bell has rung, so when we come back around, I want to know what we've taken from other jurisdictions that we can implement here that address this prevailing insidious issue of 4,500 unsafe buildings and 600 imminently dangerous buildings. But we need to wait till the next round.
Councilwoman, it is our hope that we don't have a next round. So you are the...
If you look at the ICCSafe.org, ours is the most aggressive in the country. People are coming here
to
get
pointers
from
us. So you're a
real leader,
if you will. This department is a real leader in addressing this issue.
Absolutely. We have great staff and Rebecca Swanson and all our inspectors. We are really the model for vacant strategy.
Okay. All right, then. Well, thank you for that. I just have a couple more questions. We talked about the qualifications for building inspectors. Was there discussion already given to the Eclipse program?
There was some. We do have our IT director, Linda Halcomb, who I'd like to ask to come forward to answer any questions that you may have directly related to Project Eclipse.
And I have two more after that, and I'm done, Mr. President.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. It is so great to see a woman at that table. I couldn't resist. I'm sorry, I just couldn't resist. So I thank you very, very much, Commissioner, having such a department that represents for all.
Welcome.
Okay. So my question is, with regards to the Eclipse program, what is L&I currently doing in the implementation of that program, and have any services been transferred over to the new system?
We are actively working. We kicked off January 9th of this year. We have a 12-month time frame before the first go live, which will be business licenses. We've done phase zero activities, early analysis of data conversion. We're looking at interface analysis. We've got our project governance set up. We have our success factors defined. So we're putting the infrastructure of the project in place. We have a detailed project plan we're working from. The data conversion should be done next month. So we're simply working through the project plan, data conversion, system requirements spec, interface analysis, and detailed analysis for interfacing with some of our key departments, Department of Revenue, Streets, OPA.
How does that help district council members? This is valuable data that you have. How does that, or how can that, or would that assist district council members who want, you know, always want to be in touch with everything that's happening in their districts?
With the implementation of Eclipse, we'll have robust reporting capabilities. We'll have all public data available
on the website
to be able to log in. This is a web-based system, so you can log in. You can create your own reports with the drag and drop capability.
Okay.
We can create dashboards for you. It comes with significant dashboards out of the box. You'll be able to look at your council districts only, and just have good, strong, easy access to the data.
Okay.
Whereas with the current system, as you know, we have to engage programmers to pull the data accurately out of the database.
Okay. I'm sure former Councilman Bill Green would be thrilled to know that the tech world has been infused into the work of L&I even deeper. With regards to Dale Carnegie, on page 5 of your testimony, you discussed New Vision, Mission, and Values program where 30 employees participated in Dale Carnegie Experience. Discuss that briefly and with some additional detail. And was Dale Carnegie retained as a professional service class in the service class 200 expense?
Yeah, Dale Carnegie did a great job throughout the years in the department identifying and providing leadership training to some of our inspectors for succession planning for the future. When I was appointed, one of the things that I wanted to do was to establish a new mission and vision for the department. And those 30 people that participated with Dale Carnegie did just that. Our vision for the department and for the city of Philadelphia is to be your partner in building safety. We wanted to have greater outreach. All of the things that I've heard here today was started, and this was started prior to June 5th of last year, to redesign, redevelop this department so that we'll be more accessible to the community. Mm-hmm. Inspectors need to know who their block captains are in the field so that they know who they are responsible for addressing issues in their neighborhood. They establish own your own census tract. I think what's important with that is that they need to, in that census tract, they need to know who the key leaders in that neighborhood are. When you talk to people, Councilwoman, one of the things that I learned from other departments is they really didn't understand LNI's practices and procedures and how to get things done. And so I think that that was a shortcoming of this department that I wanted to change. I wanted inspectors to have better relationships with people so that there wasn't no the secrets and that there was a full understanding of what the code means and how you use it to address bad property owners or vacant properties in your city. Those understandings help clarify our mission and role in the department so that when there are safety issues, people know what to do, how to do it, and who to call. And when LNI is involved, they know, understand how these things happen and occur. So if there's a court hearing or a zoning issue or something that's going on in a neighborhood, these things don't just pop up and say, LNI didn't tell us. Now you know in advance how to use the system to go to a hearing to protest against an illegal or a bar in your neighborhood who wants to come up if that's not what you want. Or a vacant property owner who is constantly a problematic person, those testimonies help when a judge is making a decision to say, we're going to take that property owner or we're going to force that property owner to fix and repair.
Sure.
But if the public doesn't know, then you can't get their support and ultimately they speculate and formulate their own opinions of Ellen not being lazy, incompetent people,
indeed,
which is not the case here.
Yeah, if you don't make your case, someone else will make your case for you.
Absolutely.
And seldom is it based on factual, hard, research documented data.
That is correct.
So is that experience over? Is there a tap part two to that or what?
Right now, Ms. Bernice Johnson, if she's here, I'm going to ask another lady to step forward. She can tell you what we're doing. And in that aspect, I do have a lot of other people of different ethnicities, background, and diversity in the department
who can talk about it. We did the assessment.
Very
congratulations
good
on having a department that looks like Philadelphia.
Thank you so much. I'll ask Bernice to come up and tell you what our motto is together. And we come up with our own motto, and I'm going to ask her to state for the record what our motto is in the Department of License and Inspection.
Good afternoon, Councilwoman Rose Brown, members of council. Our goal is to get results. And so what I've been doing is attending community meetings. I actually have one at 5:30 today. And I've been going to the community meetings and explaining to the public what our mission is, how the department works, what they can expect from us, how we operate, how we process complaints, and meeting with individuals from streets department to partner with them and the block captain so we can identify problems and situations in the community. So our goal, as it has always been, is to get results, but give the public a better sense of how we operate and what we do.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Okay. Thank you, Commissioner. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you. And we have a blank board. So with that, I would like to thank you very much for your testimony.
Thank you, Council President.
And keep doing the good work.
Thank you, sir.
This committee will stand in recess until Wednesday, April 9th at 10 a.m.